I am Dr. Mangesh Tiwaskar, and before I start my deliberation, let me thank first the entire DICARE Con team, including Vanshi Bhai, for giving me this opportunity. And I bring greetings to you from Mumbai. I would also like to extend my thanks and gratitude to the entire Indico team for giving me an opportunity to speak on one of the favorite molecules that I have in the DPP4 basket, that is alogliptin. And how about its role in the cardiovascular outcome safety, especially when it comes to an affordable gliptin in India? Friends, you all know that diabetes is a global burden, and nearly 134 million people are estimated to be diabetic, and India is one of the most affected of the three countries that you are seeing on the screen. Now, if we talk about the glycemic burden, the sugar burden of Indian people, you know that nearly 73 million people are currently diabetic in India, and they are undergoing treatment. And what is the biggest challenge that a diabetes offers to you is its cardiovascular outcome and the related mortalities. No matter, it could be atherosclerosis, it could be hypertension, it could be diabetic arrhythmia, it can be acute coronary syndrome, heart failure, everything contributes to the mortality. So we know that nearly 50% of the population loses life whenever diabetes is there as one of the comorbidities, whenever it comes to the cause of mortality. So gliptins have, you know, picked up in last decade and a half as one of the primary therapeutic interventions in diabetes. Now, why gliptins? Because of their distinct advantage. First, they are very effective as monotherapy. And to add to it, there is very less chance of having hypoglycemia or weight gain. Along with that, there are very, very minimal or negligible side effects. It is one of the great add-on molecules as an add-on therapy. So not only you can add it on with any of the other OHS, but it can be also used as an add-on therapy on the basic insulin therapy the patient is on. So the only therapy which you cannot add on gliptin is the GLP-1 receptor agonist therapy. And we all know that after the outcome trials that we have witnessed, that it is a cardio-neutral DPP-4 inhibitor, especially when it comes to alogliptin. And it also has some pleiotropic benefits as endothelial protection, or it also have demonstrated anti-atherogenic properties and has proved now that it might be also having some blood pressure lowering abilities. And as far as the Indian or the Southeast Asian population is concerned, we all are aware that gliptins are the great molecules. So we look back the history of the gliptin invention. We know that sitagliptin is the first gliptin which was launched around 15 years ago. And then we in India have 8 different gliptins, and alogliptin is one such gliptin which was approved. It came to India a little late, but it was approved in Japan by a Takeda Pharmaceutical Manufacturing, and it got their approval in January 2013 by Japanese PMDA. And it is special gliptin. Why? Because it is known for its very, very high DPP-4 specific inhibition and its choice over DPP-4 inhibition when it comes to the serine protease inhibition of DPP-8 and DPP-9, I would say, receptors. And that's the reason why US FDA also approved this molecule as one of the quickest approvals that any DPP-4 has won as a standalone therapy, in combination with not only metformin, but interestingly with pioglitazone as well. And look at the pharmacokinetics and the pharmacodynamics of this molecule. You can clearly see, as far as the DPP-4 selectivity is concerned, it is 14,000 times more selective to bind to DPP-4 receptor in comparison to all the other gliptins. And whenever it comes to the choice over the DPP-8 and DPP-9 selection, or the DPP-4 specific enzyme inhibition, you can see that alogliptin scores with its near, I would say, friends, Saxarsita and Vilda. I will not call them rivals. They are their friends or the same molecules in the kitty. On the top of it, alogliptin has got a better safety profile with minimum side effects of nasopharyngitis or upper respiratory infection or pancreatitis or pancreatitis as well, which is known to be there with DPP-4 inhibitors. Now, if you compare the DPP-4 inhibition versus the DPP-4, I would say, trigger, you can see that alogliptin nearly 90% of the time. So it has got a true half-life of causing a good amount of persistent DPP-4 inhibition over nearly 24 hours. And as far as the glycemic ability is concerned, as a monotherapy or as on an add-on therapy, alogliptin is not inferior to the standard of comparison gliptin, sitagliptin in any ways, and it has been documented to reduce HbA1c by nearly 0.6 to 1%. So the basic advantage of alogliptin is its safety profile, and not only that, the gliptins are weight neutral, and now with the studies which are published, they have been slowly proven to be cardio neutral. Now there were a few questions as far as the safety of, you know, especially gliptins as a whole when the results of Sevartini came, and hence an examine trial was published, a landmark cardiovascular trial of alogliptin in high risk patient pool. Remember that Sevartini partially was in a high risk pool, probably TCOS was the stable cardiovascular disease patients, but examine chose a very high risk patient pool, and they did what? They tried to determine the efficacy of alogliptin as far as the cardiovascular outcomes are concerned in all the type 2 diabetic patients, those who were very high risk for the cardiovascular event, and especially those who had the acute coronary event recently were evaluated. And there was a, I would say, equal distribution of the patient selection. And you can see that from Asia Pacific, nearly 1,000 patients were enrolled. And in India, around 400 patients were enrolled from 33 different sites. So India contributed nearly 18.5 or 19% of the patients. And then this was the recruitment which has happened. And here, alogliptin was used in the dose of 12.5 milligrams, 25 milligrams, and 6.25 milligrams as a run-in period of around a month's time. And then the follow-up visit continued and the analysis continued over a period of 4.5 years. The inclusion criteria were standard, but then patient needed to have an acute coronary syndrome within 15 to 90 days before the randomization. And the glycosylation or the glycosylated hemoglobin hobbled in between 6.5 to 11. So all the ranges of diabetes control patients were taken, with an exclusion of type 1 diabetic patients, unstable cardiac patients, very highly unstable cardiac patients were not included. And the patients, those who were in the end-stage renal disease undergoing dialysis, and those who have gone undergone dialysis within the first 14 days within or before the 14 days of randomization, they're excluded. So this was a data of nearly 5,500 patients, and it was compared, the alogliptin arm was compared to the standard placebo care arm, and the primary endpoints evaluated were cardiovascular death, non-fatal MI, and non-fatal stroke. There were secondary safety endpoints as well as on the top of the cardiovascular event. They also looked at the endpoints with additional urgent need for any intervention or revascularization or development of an unstable angina, or which will require hospitalization for heart failure. There were a few exploratory endpoints, like the people, those who had not only the cardiovascular mortality, but all-cause mortality. And additional safety endpoints were assessed by assessing the risk of pancreatitis, malignancy, hypoglycemia, angioneuritic edema, which are known side effects of DPP-4 inhibitor KIT. And look at the criteria of alogliptin versus placebo. Look at the HbA1c, they were fairly well propensity matched. You can see that, you know, adverse events reported in alogliptin arm versus placebo arm were comparable. So examine, if you really look at and if you see the conclusion of the study, it was clearly shown that alogliptin was not found to be associated with any excessive cardiovascular event, even in those high risk, fresh from the coronary event patients. And in comparison to the placebo, it did not cause any worsening. It was absolutely not inferior. So if you put all the DPP-4 cardiovascular outcome trials together, you can see that probably the examine trial was the only trial which not only looked at 3-point MACE, but as well as 4-point MACE. They looked at exploratory endpoints, and they also looked at the secondary analysis, especially when it came to the pancreatitis and the other changes, and they looked at the safety endpoints as well. So the results are that alogliptin is not associated with excessive cardiovascular event, and there is no increase in the risk of pancreatitis or pancreatic cancer in the exploratory safety analysis of these patients, and alogliptin, most importantly, did not appear to increase the risk of even new heart failure patients in even those patients, those who are very high risk for the cardiovascular events. Now, people wanted to have a relook on hospitalization for heart failure. So a re-examination, a re-evaluation of this entire examined population was done. And they looked at what? They looked at the analysis of the hospitalization for heart failure. And these patients, as we are aware, that they were fresh from the acute coronary syndrome. So they looked at not only the hospitalization with the clinical symptoms, but also they looked at the NT-proBNP, which was not done in any other trials of the cardiovascular outcomes talking about heart failure. And look at this. Alogliptin did not show any increase in the risk of hospitalization because of the heart failure. Now, if you talk about alogliptin as an add-on molecule to the insulin therapy, already the pre-existent insulin therapy is on, and they looked at the weight gain and the possibility of increasing the hypoglycemia. And this paper was an analysis of a 26 weeks randomized double-blind placebo-controlled study of around 400 patients. And what they found out, that alogliptin was one of the great agents to be used as an add-on to the insulin therapy without causing weight gain or without increasing the risk of hypoglycemia. Now, most importantly, they also found out that this drug has been beautifully tolerated across the ages, but especially in the elderly and very elderly. And even in those patients, those who were renally compromised, hepatically compromised, and those who are high risk at the cardiovascular events. Understand, friends, that alogliptin is one of the most efficacious molecules in the DPP-4-KT, not only in the other population, but especially when it comes to the Asian patients. You can easily say that alogliptin is one of the best molecules that can be used. Now, there was a very interesting study which was done to analyze even the antihypertensive property of the alogliptin. And they just did not look at the blood pressure measurement by the sphygmomanometer, but what they measured was the brachial ankle pulse wave velocity, that is BAPWV. And we all know that the standard of BAPWV was around 1947. And in comparison that was analyzed, it also represents a sort of a central aortic pressure measurement. And you can clearly see at the end of 12 months, the average brachial ankle pulse wave velocity reduced down from 1947 to 1756, which was a significant, I would say, benefit. So that concludes that even alogliptin as a DPP-4 inhibitor molecule has got some antihypertensive property as well. And the possibility of the mechanism mostly is that its effect on the NHE3 exchanger form in the glomerula, which also increases the sodium excretion and stops the sodium reabsorption. Now, there was a J-brand registry analysis which was done in the patients of type 2 diabetes, and which was not only done as a randomized analysis, but also for the long-term safety. And what they found out, that they evaluated the parameters like blood pressure, HbA1c, weight, total cholesterol, LDL cholesterol, and the randomized blood sugar levels in these patients, and especially elderly. And it was found that alogliptin is extremely beautiful and safe drug to be used in all categories. And as far as the glycemic lowering abilities is concerned, it is not inferior to sitagliptin as a molecule. It did not cause too much of alteration in the lipid molecules, and it did not increase the risk of pancreatitis. Hence, ADA 2021 guidelines even currently suggest in the patients, those who are not at the high risk of the atherosclerotic cardiovascular event or a CKD or a heart failure, and whenever the aim is to reduce down the incidence of weight gain or hypoglycemia, or whenever there is a compelling indication for the risk reduction for hypoglycemia, I think DPP-4 inhibitors, especially alogliptin, forms a great choice of the therapeutic intervention. So overall cardiovascular safety, you talk about, as far as the Indian patients are concerned, we all are aware that 55% diabetics, especially in India, they die of some cardiovascular complication. And as far as the use of gliptins or the glucose lowering therapies is concerned, we need to also understand that all the drugs need to be cost effective or the pocket friendly drugs, because Indian population uses the paying system of pay from the pocket. So diabetes in India is no longer a rich man's disease. It has reached all the peripheries, all the suburbs, all the small villages and townships. So if you look, finally, have a look on the alogliptin in a glance, you can see that as far as renal dose adjustments is concerned, yes, of course, we do require a two-step dose adjustment, especially when it comes to alogliptin. So it has little bit dose adjustment requiring gliptin, but as far as the hepatic safety is concerned, in child's class 1 and 2, mild to moderate hepatic impairment, you know, alogliptin is fairly safe in comparison to vildagliptin. As far as cardiovascular outcome safety is concerned, probably alogliptin is the only molecule which has been extensively evaluated in a very high-risk cardiovascular patients, especially fresh from the acute coronary syndrome, and they have been found to be beneficial and also needed, gave you a choice of being possibly be using as a once-in-a-day therapy. As far as the choice in the special population is concerned, pregnancy, it is not well studied, so please do not use it. It is a category B indication. As far as the US FDA indication is for the pregnancy is concerned, even though there are no, signals which have been found, teratogenic signals which were found in the animal models, but in the human models, it is not adequately evaluated. So please avoid using any DPP-4, including alogliptin in the pregnancy. As far as lactation is concerned, we don't know what happens to the drug, whether it is excreted in the or secreted in the milk or not. I should not be using the term excreted, secreted in the milk or not. So probably, you know, we need to be a bit careful, especially when you are giving any DPP-4 inhibitor in the pregnant nursing mothers or the nursing mothers, not pregnant, nursing mothers. It is not approved for the pediatric use, and it is one of the great choices in the elderly group with a little bit of caution that especially when the patients have a reduced renal functions, be a little careful. So it has got all the 10 abilities that has been mentioned here of a great oral bioavailability, highly specific DPP-4 binding, optimum HbA1c reduction with the minimal risk of hypoglycemia, technically no weight gain or weight neutrality, cardiovascular safety is outstanding, can be used from mild to severe renal impairment, but of course requires a dose adjustment, and can be easily used in mild to moderate hepatic impairment, affordable gliptin, and also advised in the ADA guidelines. Thank you very much for patient listening. I'll